Hello friends, I'm Dr. Neela Mahajan. I shall be discussing pharmaceutical aerosols part 1 formulation today. In this module, we will define pharmaceutical aerosols, we'll discuss their background and advantages, then we will discuss components of aerosol package, followed by formulation of pharmaceutical aerosols, and lastly, we shall learn about the various types of aerosol systems. Aerosols or pressurized packages are defined as systems that depend on the power of a compressed or liquefied gas to expel the contents from the container. Pharmaceutical aerosols are widely used for packaging of therapeutically active ingredients in a pressurized system. Due to both patient and physician acceptability of these pressurized packages, pharmaceutical aerosols represent a significant dosage form. Now let us discuss the background of pharmaceutical aerosols. The year 1942 marked the beginning of aerosol industry. In early 1950s, the principles of aerosol technology were applied to the development of pharmaceutical aerosols used for topical administration for treatment of burns, minor cuts and bruises, infections and various other dermatological conditions. Aerosol products intended for local activity in the respiratory tract, for example, epinephrine pressurized package, were made available in the year 1955. Now, the advantages over other dosage forms. Advantages of pharmaceutical aerosols over other dosage forms include dose removal without contamination of the remaining material is possible. Second advantage is enhanced stability for substances which are adversely affected by oxygen and moisture. Third advantage is maintenance of sterility while dispensing a dose. These also allow direct delivery to affected area in a desired form with minimum or no irritation due to application. Further, aerosols have rapid onset of action, circumvent first pass effect, and avoid degradation in the gastrointestinal tract. Dose lowering in case of steroid therapy and dose titration to individual needs is achievable with aerosols. Aerosols are the alternate route of administration for drugs showing erratic pharmacokinetics upon oral or parenteral administration. Aerosols are tamper-proof systems and easily and conveniently applied in a thin layer. After learning about the advantages of pharmaceutical aerosols, let us discuss the components of aerosol package. An aerosol product consists of various component parts including propellant, container, valve, actuator, and product concentrate. Let us discuss propellants first. Under the category propellants, the first type of propellants are liquefied gases. These are widely used propellants, relatively inert, non-toxic, and non-flammable, and are gaseous at room temperature and atmospheric pressure, and can be liquefied easily by lowering the temperature or by increasing the pressure. When placed into a sealed container, these immediately separate into a liquid and a vapor phase and are very effective in dispersing active ingredients into a fine mist or foam. Further, these maintain a constant pressure within the container. Examples include chlorofluorocarbons, hydrochlorofluorocarbons, and hydrofluorocarbons. Fluorinated hydrocarbons are widely used in aerosols for oral and inhalation use. The next type of propellants used are hydrocarbons. These are flammable, less toxic, less dense, more economic, more soluble, and chemically more stable, and are used in topical pharmaceutical aerosols. Examples include butane, propane, isobutane, and their mixtures. Initially, hydrocarbons were restricted to use with foams and water-based aerosols With the development of newer valve technology, their use has been extended to solvent-based aerosols as well. Now we shall discuss compressed gases. Compressed gases have little expansion power, produce a fairly wet spray and less stable foam as compared to liquefied gases, for example, nitrogen, nitrous oxide, and carbon dioxide. Compressed gases do not have a chilling effect and are used in topical pharmaceutical aerosols like hair preparations, ointments, dental creams, aqueous germicidal and antiseptic aerosols, contact lens cleaner, and food products. Compressed gases are of limited value in aqueous products where propellant and water were not miscible. While compressed gases overcome immiscibility, there are other problems like loss of propellant and, to a lesser degree, dispersion of the spray. Hence, pump system is used for liquid antiseptics, germicides, and nasal sprays. After propellant, it is a turn to discuss containers used for aerosols. Various materials used for the manufacture of aerosol containers must withstand pressures as high as 140 to 180 psig at 130 degree Fahrenheit, including metal and glass. Tin-plated steel containers consist of a sheet of steel plate that has been electroplated on both sides with tin. Most non-aqueous products, including many alcohol-based pharmaceuticals, can be placed into an unlined tin-plated metal container. But for packing, aqueous products having a low pH, organic linings of epoxy and vinyl resins are used. Vinyl resin forms a tough film poorly resistant to steam and cannot be used for products that must be heat sterilized or filled hot. For this purpose, an epoxy resin can be used due to greater degree of heat stability. A commonly used organic coating consists of an undercoat of vinyl and a top coat of epoxy resin. Products containing soaps utilize similar liners. It is important that specifications for containers include these considerations and that product stability versus composition of solder should be evaluated. For this reason, welded side seam containers are now preferred for use with pharmaceuticals. Now the aluminum containers. Aluminum containers are seamless, resistant to corrosion, and exhibit lesser incompatibility problems. Special attention should be given to those products containing alcohol and packaged in aluminum containers. Anhydrous ethanol is extremely corrosive to aluminum and increases the pressure in the container. This increase in pressure, along with the general dissolution of some of the aluminum, may lead to rupturing of the container. This reaction can be reduced or prevented by anodizing aluminum and adding water to formula. Presence of 2 to 3% water tends to inhibit the reaction. Non-polar solvents appear to be relatively safer in aluminum containers. Polar solvents tend to be corrosive to bare aluminum, but reaction can be controlled by addition of water and other inhibitors. Stainless steel containers are used for inhalation aerosols. These containers are extremely strong and resistant to most materials, but limited to smaller sizes due to production problems and the cost. After discussing tin-plated steel, aluminum, and stainless steel, now it is the turn to discuss the glass containers. Glass containers may be uncoated or plastic coated. These are preferred for flexibility in design, compatibility, and absence of corrosion problems. These are satisfactory for packaging of aerosols prepared by adjusting the formulation and limiting the type and quantity of propellant. Their use is limited due to their brittleness and danger of breakage if the container is accidentally being dropped. When the total pressure of the system is below 25 psig and there is not more than 15% propellant, glass can be safely used. Pressures up to 33 psig can be used in conjunction with a glass container having a double plastic outer coating. After having an understanding of the factors affecting the selection of a suitable container for packaging pharmaceutical aerosols, it is equally important to understand and discuss valves. Pharmaceutical aerosols may be dispensed as spray, foam, or solid stream, and they may or may not require dosage control. Therefore, several different types of valves are needed with usually more stringent requirements. Aerosol valves are thus multifunctional and can be easily opened and closed and deliver the content in the desired form. Now we will discuss the continuous spray valves. An aerosol valve comprises of many different parts and is assembled using high-speed production techniques. Typical aerosol valve assemblies consist of various parts which we will discuss further. First of all, we will discuss ferrule or mounting cup. It is used to attach the valve proper to glass bottles or small aluminium tubes and are usually attached to the container either by rolling the end under the lip of the bottle or by clinching the metal under the lip. The next in the line is wall body or housing. Wall body or housing comprises of an opening at the point of attachment of the dip tube ranging from about 0.013 inch to 0.080 inch. The housing may or may not contain another opening called as vapor tap. The vapor tap allows for escape of vaporized propellant along with liquid product. It further produces a fine particle size, prevents valve clogging with products containing insoluble materials, allows for product to be satisfactorily dispensed with the container being in the inverted position, reduces the chilling effect of the propellant on the skin, and in the case of hydrocarbon propellants, allows for a decrease in flame extension. Various orifices are set into the stem. Now, gasket. Gasket is made from butadiene and neoprene rubber and is compatible with most of the pharmaceutical formulation. Now, coming over to dip tubes. Dip tubes are made from polyethylene or polypropylene. Polypropylene tubes are usually more rigid. Inner diameter of the dip tube is selected based on desired viscosity and delivery rate. Metering valves are used for dispensing of potent medication with limitation of accuracy and dosage. Approximately 50 to 150 milligram plus minus 10% of liquid material can be dispensed at one time with such valves. Last but not the least, we will discuss actuators. Actuator is a specially designed button fitted to the valve stem to ensure proper delivery of the aerosol in the desired form. It allows easy opening and closing of the valve and is an integral part of almost every aerosol package. There are different types of actuators which produce either spray, foam, solid stream, and those which are used for special applications. Now we shall discuss the various types of actuators. First actuator that we will discuss is spray actuator. Spray actuators disperse the stream of product concentrate and propellant into relatively small particles through various openings. These are used with pharmaceuticals intended for topical use like spray-on bandages, antiseptics, local anesthetics, foot preparations. When spray actuators are used with aerosols containing 50% or less of propellants, the product is dispensed as a stream rather than a spray due to insufficient propellant for dispersing the product fully. For these products, a mechanical breakup actuator is actually required. These actuators are capable of mechanically breaking a stream into fine particles by causing the steam to swirl through various channels built into the actuator. Now, foam actuators. Foam actuators consist of relatively large orifices ranging from approximately 0.07 inch to 0.125 inch and greater. The orifices lead the product into a relatively larger chamber where it expands and gets dispensed. Solid stream actuators are used for dispensing of semi-solid products, and special actuators are specially designed to deliver the medication to appropriate site of action, including throat, nose, eye or vaginal tract. By now we have become familiar with the components of an aerosol package. Now we shall have an understanding of formulation of pharmaceutical aerosols. An aerosol formulation consists of two essential components, namely product concentrate and propellant. Product concentrate comprises of active ingredients or a mixture of active ingredients and other necessary agents. The propellant may be a single propellant or a blend of various propellants. The propellant is selected to give the desired vapor pressure, solubility, and particle size. Propellants can be combined with active ingredients in many different ways, producing products with varying characteristics. Depending on the type of aerosol system utilized, the pharmaceutical aerosols may be dispensed as fine mist, wet spray, quick breaking foam, stable foam, semi-solid or solid. Type of system selected depends on many factors including physical, chemical and pharmacological properties of active ingredients and the site of application. There are three types of systems. The first system is solution system or two-phase system. It consists of a vapor phase and a liquid phase. When the active ingredients are soluble in the propellant, no other solvent is required. Depending on the type of spray required, propellant may consist of propellant 12 or A70 to produce very fine particles, or a mixture of propellant 12 and other propellants. As other propellants with vapor pressures lower than that of propellant 12 are added to propellant 12, the pressure of the system decreases. It results in production of larger particles. A lowering of the vapor pressure also is produced through the addition of less volatile solvents like ethanol, propylene glycol, ethyl acetate, glycerin, and acetone. Amount of propellant used may vary from 5% for foams to 95% for inhalation products of the entire formulation. When a spray is produced with larger particles, a decrease is observed in the number of fine particles, decreasing the danger of inhaling these materials through formation and subsequent inhalation of airborne particles. These sprays are also useful for topical preparations because they tend to coat the affected area with a film of active ingredients. Depending on the boiling point of solvent used, rate of vaporization of propellant is decreased, thereby increasing any chilling effect that may be present. Now we will talk about water-based systems. Talking about three-phase systems, relatively large amounts of water can be used to replace all or part of the non-aqueous solvents used in aerosols. These products are generally referred to as water-based aerosols and, depending on the formulation, are emitted as either a spray or a foam. Propellant content in these systems varies from about 25 to 60% but can be as low as 5% depending on the nature of the product. To achieve the desired fine particle size with products containing large amounts of water and a low proportion of propellant, a mechanical breakup actuator must be used along with a vapor tap valve. To produce a spray, formulation must consist of a dispersion of active ingredients and other solvents in an emulsion system in which the propellant is in external phase. In this case, when the product is dispensed, the propellant vaporizes and disperses the active ingredients into minute particles. Since propellant and water are not miscible, a three-phase aerosol forms, consisting of propellant phase, water phase, and vapor phase. Ethanol has been used as a co-solvent to solubilize some of the propellant in the water. By virtue of its surface tension lowering properties, ethanol also helps in the production of small particles. About 0.5 to 2% of surfactants with low water solubility and high solubility in nonpolar solvents are used to produce a satisfactory homogeneous dispersion. For example, glycol, glycerol, and sorbitol esters of oleic, stearic, palmitic, and lauric acids. Now we shall talk about aquasol system. It is essentially a three-phase aerosol which permits the use of fairly large quantities of water in the formulation. It allows for the dispensing of a fine mist or spray of active ingredient dissolved in water, which is not possible with the usual three-phase system. It dispenses a fairly dry spray with very small particles. This relative dryness and small particle size are due chiefly to the design of the valve, which dispenses vaporized propellant rather than liquefied propellant. It is designed to dispense pressurized products efficiently and economically using relatively small amounts of hydrocarbon propellant. However, it can also function effectively using fluorocarbon propellants. In addition, the vaporized propellant contributes to the non-flammability of the stream of the product as it is dispensed. Since only active ingredient and water are dispensed, there is no chilling effect as occurs with hydrocarbon propellant. A fine, almost dry spray is obtained using 6 parts of water with 1 part of hydrocarbon propellant. The spray is not only non-flammable, but it actually extinguishes an open flame. Active ingredient is dissolved or suspended in water or in a mixture of alcohol and water. Hydrocarbon propellant floats on top of the aqueous layer and exists as both a liquid and a vapor. Depending on the amount of alcohol present in the aqueous layer, propellant and water alcohol layer may or may not be immiscible. As the amount of alcohol increases, the miscibility of these two layers increases. As a pure alcohol system is approached, complete miscibility occurs, at which time a two-phase system that can function satisfactorily is produced. Flammability is increased, however, owing to the large amount of alcohol present, as well as to the fact that liquid propellant is now also being dispensed. In the aquasol system, the vapor phase of the propellant and the product enter the mixing chamber of actuator through separate ducts or channels. Moving at tremendous velocity, the vaporized propellant enters into the actuator while the product is forced into the actuator by the pressure of the propellant. At this point, product and vapor are mixed with violent force, resulting in a uniform, finally dispersed spray. Depending on the configuration of the valve and actuator, either a fine dry spray or a coarse wet spray can be obtained. A fine dry spray is obtained when a ratio of about 6 parts of product to 1 part of propellant is used. Up to 30 parts of product to 1 part of propellant has also produced a satisfactory spray, but in this case, a more coarse spray results. In the aquasol system, it is almost impossible to dispense only the pure propellant until the package is depleted of the aqueous product. Now we will discuss suspension or dispersion system. Various methods have been used to overcome the difficulties encountered due to the use of aqueous solvent. One such system involves a dispersion of active ingredients in the propellant or a mixture of propellants. Various surfactants or suspending agents have been added to the systems to decrease the rate of settling of the dispersed particles. These systems have been developed primarily for use with oral inhalation aerosols. Physical stability of an aerosol dispersion can be increased by adopting various measures, including control of moisture content, reduction of initial particle size to less than 5 microns, use of derivatives of active ingredients with minimum solubility in propellant system, use of dispersing agents, and by adjustment of density of propellant and suspensoid so that they are equalized. Vapor tap valves also have been used with dispersion aerosols to decrease the danger of valve clogging. Added propellant escaping as a vapor helps in clearing the valve of solid particles. Particles of certain materials tend to agglomerate immediately following suspension or shortly thereafter due to solubility, moisture, or particle size growth with unacceptable consequences. Unacceptable consequences of agglomeration include valve clogging, damage to the liner, inaccuracy of dosage, and damage to the metal container. Degree of agglomeration is accelerated at elevated temperatures. Agglomeration may range in degree from flocculation to aggregation. Caking results when aggregates become massive. In severe cases, the particles may adhere to walls of the container. Higher moisture levels generally result in particle agglomeration. Moisture content of both the suspensoid and the propellant affects the stability of the aerosol system and must be below 300 ppm. To achieve this level, rigid control over conditions of manufacture is required, and it is necessary to dry both the suspensoid and the propellant prior to manufacture by passing the propellant through various desiccants. Physical stability of a dispersed system depends primarily on the rate of agglomeration of the suspensoid, which depends on the initial particle size of the drug, which must be in the range of 1 to 5 microns. This particle size range is necessary to ensure that the particles reach the intended site of action. Suspensions containing materials intended for topical administration do not require particles of the same degree of dispersion as inhalation aerosols, but for reasons of physical stability, particles are seldom over 50 microns in size. Active ingredients may be reduced to required particle sizes through use of suitable grinding equipment. Materials suspended in a vehicle in which they are partially soluble show signs of particle size growth. This can be avoided by selecting a chemical derivative of the drug that shows minimum solubility in the propellant vehicle. From a physiological viewpoint, drug must show some solubility in the fluids surrounding the lung tissues. Surfactants exert their activity by coating each of the particles in suspension and become oriented at the solid-liquid interface. Agglomeration is reduced, thereby increasing stability by providing a physical barrier. Non-ionic surfactants were found to be most effective. Those surfactants having an HLB value less than 10, such as sorbitan trioleate, could be utilized for aerosol dispersions. Such agents as isopropyl myristate and mineral oils reduce agglomeration and act as lubricant for the particles in passing through the valve orifices. Now we will discuss foam systems. Emulsion and foam aerosols consist of active ingredients, aqueous or non-aqueous vehicle, surfactant, and propellant. These are dispensed as stable or quick breaking foam depending on the nature of the ingredients and the formulation. The liquefied propellant is emulsified and is generally found in the internal phase. Non-aerosol emulsions are usually in lotion or viscous liquid form. Aerosol emulsions are dispensed as foams, and this can be advantageous for various applications involving irritating ingredients or when the material is applied to a limited area. Now we will discuss aqueous stable foams. Aqueous stable foams are formulated with total propellant content about 8 to 10% B/V or 3 to 5% W/W and as high as 5% in certain cases. As the amount of propellant A70, A46, etc. increases, a stiffer and drier foam is produced. Lower propellant concentrations yield wetter foams. Now talking about non-aqueous stable foams. Non-aqueous stable foams may be formulated through the use of various glycols like polyethylene glycol and are formulated using emulsifying agents from the class of glycol esters, for example, propylene glycol monostearate. Various medicinal agents can also be incorporated into this base. Lastly, we shall talk about quick breaking foams. In this system, propellant is in the external phase. When dispensed, the product is emitted as foam, which then collapses into a liquid. This type of system is especially applicable to topical medication, which can be applied to limited or large areas without the use of a mechanical force to dispense the active ingredients. The surfactants used in these foams can be of non-ionic, anionic, or cationic type, and they should be soluble in both alcohol and water. If the proportion of the ingredients is varied, foams may be obtained having a wide range in stability. So friends, in this module, we defined pharmaceutical aerosols, discussed their background and advantages. It was followed by a discussion on the components of aerosol packages and formulation of pharmaceutical aerosols. And last but not the least, we discussed the various types of aerosol systems. Thank you.